Hi everyone, it's the Math Sorcerer here with Chegg. In this video, we're going to discuss curve sketching. Whenever you're trying to sketch a curve, you should try to find the things you see here on the screen. So intercepts, asymptotes, where the function is increasing or decreasing, does it have any maximums or minimums, is it concave up or concave down, and any inflection points. You won't always be able to find all of these things, but most of the time you can find quite a few of them. Let's go ahead and go through an example where we attempt to find everything you see here that's on the screen. Our example is f of x equals 4x squared over x squared minus 9. Let's work through it. Solution. Let's start by finding the y-intercept. So y-int. To find the y-intercept, you just always plug in 0 for your x. So it's f of 0 equals, and then you can put a 0 here, so 4 times 0 squared. Over, and then 0 squared minus 9. So you end up with 0 in the numerator over minus 9. Whenever you have 0 up top, you just get 0. The ordered pair would be 0, comma 0. That would be the y-intercept. The x-intercept is going to be exactly the same, but I'll show you the procedure. So to find the x-intercept, you just always take your entire function, and you set it equal to 0. So 4x squared over x squared minus 9 equals 0. And then the key thing here is whenever you have a fraction equal to 0, you can automatically set the numerator equal to 0. That's super important. So fraction equal to 0, numerator equal to 0. The reason is you can multiply both sides by x squared minus 9 like I'm doing here. And basically on the left-hand side, they'll cancel. And on the right-hand side, you'll get 0 times what you're multiplying by, so 0. This is super easy to solve. Divide by 4, take the square root. You get x equals 0. So when y equals 0, x equals 0, so your x-intercept is 0, 0. Notice I'm putting things in boxes. That's because these problems get super messy, and so it helps you keep things organized. Let's find the asymptotes. VA stands for vertical asymptote. For these, you want to look at your function, make sure nothing cancels, nothing does. So once it's reduced, as this one already is, you take the bottom and you set it equal to 0, and you solve. In this case, we can factor or we can add 9. I'll add 9. And then when you take the square root of a variable term like this, you get a plus or minus, so plus or minus 3. Those would be the vertical asymptotes. We can get a pretty good picture already with what we have, but let's keep going. And then HA would be the horizontal asymptote. We know it has one because if you look at your function, the degree in the numerator is 2, and the degree in the denominator is also 2. So whenever the degrees match, you're always going to have a horizontal asymptote. And the HA is the ratio of the leading coefficients, so it'll be 4 over 1. So it's y equals 4 over 1, which is y equals 4. Super, super important. You can also take the limit, and that would also work. If you took the limit, you would get 4 over 1. All right, let's go ahead and find some derivatives. So we're gonna have to use the quotient rule for this derivative. I'm gonna refresh your memory. I'll write it up here in red. You have f over g, and you take the derivative. Think of f as your top function and g as your bottom. That's the derivative of the top times the bottom minus the top times the derivative of the bottom all over the bottom one squared. Let's apply that to our particular example. So we have f prime of x, it's the derivative of the top function, which is going to be 8x via the power rule, times the bottom, so x squared minus 9, minus the top, so 4x squared, times the derivative of the bottom, so 2x, all divided by the bottom 1 squared. You become a master at the quotient rule by doing exercises involving curve sketching, because a whole lot of them require the quotient rule. Let's just double check it really quickly. Derivative of the top is 8x times the bottom, x squared minus 9, minus the top, 4x squared, times the derivative of the bottom, which is 2x, over the bottom 1 squared. All is good. We can clean this up. Distributing the 8x, 8x times x squared is 8x cubed, and then 8x times minus 9 is minus 72x, and the last term will be minus 8x cubed. All divided by x squared minus 9 quantity squared. And these cancel, these 8x cubes, so we have f prime of x equals negative 72x over, and then we have x squared minus 9 squared. So this is the first derivative, super important. And now that we have it, if we set it equal to 0, we can find critical numbers. And again, when you set it equal to 0, you automatically set the numerator equal to 0. You get negative 72x equals 0, and that gives us our first critical number and our only critical number, x equals 0. This is a CN, it's a critical number. Now that we have our critical number, what we can do is draw a number line. I'm going to draw it like this. And what you want to do now is you want to plot all critical numbers you have and any other points of interest, so like asymptotes. So critical numbers and asymptotes. Our asymptotes were plus or minus 3, so here's 3, and here's negative 3. And now we want to investigate the sign of the first derivative. Is it positive? Is it negative? We need to figure that out. So you can plug in numbers. However, in this case, it's really easy to tell what the answer is going to be. I'll plug in one number just to show you. Let's pick negative 4. Let's plug in negative 4. When you do that, you get negative 72 times negative 4 over, and then we have negative 4 squared minus 9 squared. So it's a big mess. But the point is that the bottom piece is always positive, and the top, because it's negative times negative, is positive. So it's going to be positive over here for x less than negative 3. So the function's actually increasing, so I'll draw an arrow. And you can see from this that when x is negative, the whole thing is going to be positive. So if x is negative, your first derivative is positive. So over here, between negative 3 and 0, it's also positive. But check this out. If I plug in a positive number like 1, I get negative 72 times 1 over, and then we'd get 1 squared minus 9 squared. Again, the bottom is always positive because it's squared, but now the top is negative, so it's decreasing. Same thing over here. For numbers bigger than 3, if I plug in like 10 or something, it's also going to be negative, so decreasing. So this little graph here tells you where the function is increasing and decreasing, which is super useful. It also tells you where you have a max or a min. Notice here the function's increasing, 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 and then it starts decreasing. So at 0, we're going to have a maximum. To find the y value of the maximum, basically you plug it into your original function. So you plug in 0, and we know we get 0 because we did it before. So we have a max at 0, 0. Very, very powerful stuff. This picture tells you where it's increasing, right? The arrows going up mean increasing, and it tells you where it's decreasing. And if you have this shape like this, that means you're going to have a max. If instead you had a shape that was like a U, in that case, you would have a min. At this point, we are ready to sketch the graph. Let's go ahead and do it. So basically, you just draw your y-axis, you draw your x-axis, and then you plot all of your intercepts and asymptotes. So our only intercept was at 0, 0, and we had vertical asymptotes at 3, and also at negative 3. We have two vertical asymptotes. And we also had a horizontal asymptote at 4, so 1, 2, 3, 4. And honestly, once you have your asymptotes and intercepts, it's pretty simple. So the graph must look like this, because it has to approach the asymptotes, and we know we have a max at 0, 0. Also, it cannot look like this, because then it would cross the x-axis, and we know that only happens at 0, 0. So it must happen up here on the right, likewise up here on the left. You'll also notice that the graph is increasing over here on the left and decreasing on the right side over here, and that agrees with the first derivative. If you would have found the second derivative, you would see it's concave up, precisely where it's concave up on the left and the right, and concave down in the middle. But it really was not necessary in this particular example. Hopefully this video has taught you some mathematics, and if you enjoyed this video, make sure to check out other videos on Chegg. Until next time, good luck.